So, right, so can we start now? We can chat afterwards, I mean, over lunch or something. I don't know. But, I don't know. So, a quick announcement, right? Oh, what happened here? Yeah. Very weird. It is not working. Why? Well, we're just gonna have to make do with the one thing, right? Doesn't seem to want to work yet. So, just one announcement. So, Dr. Dorenzi is coming back tomorrow. He's flying in tomorrow. He says he's going to arrive in Cape Town. He's arriving in Cape Town at 8, so he's back tomorrow, and he'll probably be back in good time to take you in tomorrow's session. So what I'm trying to say is, surprise, today is my last day with you. Well, 2 days. No, but those hours, are they crocodile? No, is there such a thing as crocodile lies? I don't know, single crocodile tears and all that. Just say, yeah, you know, go on. I just wanted to say that, take this thing seriously, you know, wish you luck, you know, I hope you find what you're looking for, and most importantly, I hope you work hard and pass. You must work hard and pass, right? So, we are going to continue off from, we're going to continue off from yesterday's session, right? Oh, come on. Really? We're going to continue from yesterday's session, right? When we were trying to rewrite the sub-minimum example that we did with Dr. Dorenzi, what I did is to try and cut down on the time. What I did was when I went home, no, I won't say when I went home. Early this morning, what I did was I just decided to write it, and then I figured it would save us some time if we just walked through what I wrote, right? Because we already understand what's going on now. Right? We know that using the four-step process that we devised together as a group, we know that when we're writing interactive programs that are mathematical in nature, that require mathematical computation, we decided as a group collectively, it was unanimous actually, that it would be a four-step process where we first of all ask the user to specify the input, perform a string to a numeric data type conversion, perform the mathematical computations, and then print out the result, right? So back to our sub-minimum example, we actually figured out that we needed 4 input values from the user, right? The corresponding figure for exam score, the test scores, the practical scores, and the practice scores, right? And just as a reminder, we know that for us to get DP, we need 50%, at least 50% in the final score, at least 45% in the practical component of the assessment, and then at least 45% in the theoretical component, right? And then we get DPR, a DP. If not, we get DPR. We wouldn't want to get DPR, we want DP. So after we ask the user for input, what we do is we do this string to numeric data type conversion, right? Simple stuff, we're just leveraging the built-in eval function, right? And then subsequently perform the mathematical computations. In this case, we're trying to compute the final score, the theory component score, and the practical component score, right? So this is easy stuff because we don't need to do a lot of thinking, right? The formula is already available for us, right? We know that the formula is there, right? This is the formula, 0.6 times the exam score, plus 0.5 by the test score, plus 0.15 by the practical score, plus 0.10 by the practical test component, right? We do the same thing for the theory component and the practical component. And then afterwards, finally, we print out the result, and voila, we are done, right? Afterwards, we run our program, and this is what happens. So this is me. No, this is you. This is you in June or something when they compute your DP score, right? So she gets, like, I don't know, she's a whiz kid, she's at 98% in the exam score, and then test scores, she get 100%. You can't get 120%, can we? Practical scores, guys, practical, this is dead giveaway. Like, if you want to get free marks, just all you have to do is make sure that you do those assignments. And I mean, there are people, a lot of people do get 100%, right? Practice are usually open book, like, kind of thing, so you have access to class notes and all those things. The only constraint you have is the time. So practice, she gets like, I don't know, 99.9, if there's such a thing. And then this is, yeah, well, it's hypothetical, but it's her. So this is it. I mean, this is what our program does. Easy stuff, right? All we have to know is, remember, when we're writing interactive programs, we ask for input from the user. If it's a program that leverages mathematical expressions, ask for input, convert the string to numeric data types, perform your computation, print out the result. Easy stuff, right? Right. So are there any questions before we proceed? I don't think so. Yes? I don't think so. Guys, before we proceed, I was asking these guys, I was asking them, do you think, hi, oh, you already know the answer to this. Oh, yeah. Oh, right. Oh, I'm sorry. Guys, I suppose that's a good trait. If there's one good trait I've picked up in Cape Town. I've been in Cape Town, I've been in South Africa for 5 years now. Yeah. I don't know, I think it's interaction with more and more people now. I wasn't this fluent in English, and I certainly wasn't this fast, but I suppose a sign that I've changed. So the four-step process is, step one, you ask for input from the user. Step two is you convert the string equivalent to numeric data types. Step three is you perform the mathematical computations, and then step four is you print out the thing. But remember that Matthew told us that we can condense step one and two, right? And we said that that is a good thing if we're trying to cut down on time. But during this formative stage of our introduction to CS 1015, we want to make sure that we expand these things as long as possible so that we try and understand what's going on. And then with time, once all this becomes muscle memory, then we can condense things, you know, and write shorthand notations. Yeah. Simple example, here's what happens. Let's print 4 plus 10. Guys, 4 plus 10 can never be 410. The reason this is happening is because we are basically concatenating string data types here, right? What Python thinks is you're trying to combine the two strings. But what you want to do is you want to make sure that you apply eval to these two numeric strings so that you convert them from strings to what? Is this?
Var one equals
10.
And then the next one you say print 0.6 times variable 1.
0.6 times?
Times that variable. Times variable 1. Should that work or not?
I don't know. It does.
Then you didn't have to use the evaluate.
Yeah, but that's because var 1 is. Does this make sense? Well, we have to do it now. Thanks. Guys, do you think this would, before we proceed here to the good stuff, the exciting stuff, excuse me, do you think that would work? I'm trying to put you on the spot. Do you think, any takers, do you think this would work? I don't need to be shy here. You know, make mistakes. This is, you're not being tested here. You're not getting any marks or losing any marks. I mean, it would work, right? As it happens, like, there's no limit, you know, to the length of your variables in Python. This is insane, right? But someone pointed out in the previous class, but his immediate reaction, but would this make sense? And I told him, hey, probably not, right? It probably wouldn't make sense. I mean, people would think you're crazy for doing this. This is 186 characters long, right? It wouldn't make sense. But I was just trying to point out the fact that these are some of the rules you should remember with regards to variable naming conventions, right? For those of us that are interested in recommended style guides for writing Python code, look at PIP 8. Just Google up PIP 8, so Python Enhancement Proposal Number 8. It tells you exactly how you should name your variable, how you should indent your code when you start indenting and all those things, you know, where you should place spaces and all that. So yeah, this works. So we're going to proceed to problem number 7. And problem number 7 is interesting because it's at this point we know that we understand the four-step process, and what we're trying to do now is just to think a little bit, right? Let's assume that we have a minimum function, right, that takes in two parameters. As it happens, there is a minimum built-in function, by the way, but we're assuming here that we don't know it's there. Well, we're assuming we know it's there, but it only takes in two variables. But the built-in function actually takes in more than two variables, right? When you type in, here's what I'm saying. When you type in, the mean is there. I told you when you see dr, if you want to look at the built-in variables, we said you could do this, right? It's not coming in the exam. I'm just saying it is a mean is somewhere there. There we go. Here's mean, right? So what we're saying is that if mean exists, and what mean does is look at what mean does. 10, 1, 2. Minus 4. This is what mean does. But what we're saying is that for this particular example, let's assume that mean only takes in two parameters, right? How would we write a program to calculate the minimum of three integers? What sort of algorithm would we, I mean, how stepwise, I mean, what would we have to do here, right? You know, right? I was looking at you. Just try, you know. I could claim to say I can try, but I mean, I already know what's happening, so that would be cheating, right? But. Yes, okay, fine, thank you. Let's go with the three-step process, right? Let's remember to annotate this code, right? Minimum of three numbers. And the author is me, right? And the date is February 23rd, 2016. So, input, user input, right? Let's do it stepwise. That's good. Before we go to the algorithms, it's fine. So three input values, right? Number one, number two, number three, right? And in all these three cases, all we are doing is, and we're going to leverage, I'm getting old, guys. What's his name? Was that Matthew? Was that you, Matthew? Just say yes, but enter number one, right? So Matthew said, we're trying to cut down on time. Matthew suggested that we compress process number one and two into one, right? We don't have to do the string conversion after we elicit input. We can do it all at once, right? Which is what we're doing in line number 6 through to 9, right? So we are using notice that we're using the input and the eval together combined, right? We're just chaining these two different variables, right? And let's not forget to save this. And we just say this is mean in Alex, right? So let's compute now, right? We know that we're saying that, listen guys, if we have let's not waste time. If we have three numbers, we know that if we can find the minimum of the first two input values, then we can use the result from the first two input values to find the minimum of the result and the third number, right? That's our algorithm. It's simple, right? So we're going to first of all start with 1 and 2, right? We find the mean of variable number 1 and variable number 2, right? And then what we're saying is that once we get this, we can get the final result by computing the mean of variable 1 and 2, which is the intermediate result, and what? And variable number 3. And then finally, we can print out the result. Right? Is this making sense, guys? Let's just quickly run it. We'll hold on after we run it and see if. Negative 101, 2, and negative. What's the answer? He knows the answer, right? What would be the answer here? What's the minimum of? I remember my algebra, right? I did like algebraic expressions a long time ago, right? But there we go, it works, right? So our algorithm is simple, right? We're just making use of the mean built-in function to first of all compute the intermediate result of the first two numbers. You could do it, you know, by flipping these things around. You can compute, if you want, you can compute the intermediate result of number 1 and number 3, and then use that intermediate result to compute the minimum of the intermediate result and number 2. It works either way, right? Problem-solving skills is what we're looking at here. So someone was saying we hold on. Do we still hold on or we proceed? Is this making sense now? I don't quite know what to make of. I've never figured out what it means when people remain quiet. You know, I don't know if not making sense or, you know, get out of here. So yes, miss. Did you apply eval? Can we debug it afterwards if you want? We can debug your code afterwards after class. Is that fine? Well, I'm saying we can fix it. We can fix it afterwards. Because then I'd have to walk over there and see what's going on. You know, which is, can we look at it together with the person next to you? I'm assuming you're doing it together. We can look at it and see what the problem is. Right. So this makes sense, I hope. So here's, we are hoping that by the end of this class, we want to know exactly how to make use of a very exciting module that comes bundled. It comes bundled with the Python installation or the Python interpreter. The only caveat is that we need to explicitly tell Python that we want to use this module, right? So it's a math library, right? It has like a number of exciting functions that we can use to perform mathematical expressions, things like, you know, square root of numbers, you know, the cosine of a number, and all those fancy things, right? Log of a particular number. We'll soon see how we go about doing this, right? There's just a few concepts we need to grasp before we can actually become comfortable with this, but it should be easy afterwards, right? Right. So a few other concepts before we narrow down to the math module. We have this slide up because you're bound to probably come across this shorthand notation at some point when you're reading through online notes and, you know, whatever Python books you're using, right? So whenever you see, you see the first bullet point there, A plus equals 3, that's basically a shorthand notation, and Python immediately knows that what you're trying to do is an actual fact add A plus the number that is after the equal sign, right? So A plus equals 3 is basically the same as A is equals to A plus 3. It's a shorthand notation. You realize that as you hone your skills, you know, when it comes to Python programming, you prefer to do things a certain way. You know, there are people that might prefer to do it, using the shorthand notation. Some will prefer to do it, using the normal notation. I prefer the normal one. It makes my code a lot clearer. So, with regards to implicit conversions, we already know what implicit conversion is all about because we've actually realized that there's a time when, so there have been times when we are, let's say, performing certain mathematical expressions that involve an integer and a floating point number. And funny enough, what happens is the result is always a floating point number, right? I mean, try and divide 1 and, well, try and add 1 and 6.91111. integer plus floating point number gives you floating point number, right? Floating point numbers take precedence over integer values, right? Divide 1 and 3 result is a floating point number because internally what Python does is automatically converts the result into a floating point number, right? Implicitly, there's casting that happens. So you're converting the result from an integer expression to a floating point number, right? But irrespective of the order, whether you're adding an integer or a floating point number, or if it's a floating point number plus an integer value, the result will always be a floating point number. What we're saying is that if you have 1 plus 2.5, floating point number, if you flip these around, 2.5 plus 1 will still be floating point number, right? Floating point numbers take precedence here, right? And we discovered that when it comes to explicit confessions, we have a couple of options. And we know that we can leverage the three methods that we, the three functions, built-in functions that we looked at, right? The eval, int, and float, right? But we realize that what eval does is it makes our life a lot easier because it, irrespective of whether or not your input value, if it's a string, is a floating point number or an integer value, it will know internally that you know what the user has inputted is actually a floating point number or an integer value, right? But if you choose to explicitly use either the int and the float, then, or if you choose to not use the eval, and you have an interactive program that asks for input from the user, what you'd have to do, you'd have to explicitly convert those values to their appropriate data types, depending on what your output result is, right? So for instance, if you are, let's say your mathematical expression is 1 plus 2.5, for instance, and you know that the result is always going to be a floating point number. For you to get an integer value, use what? Int to do this, explicitly. Someone asked yesterday, why is this giving me a float? I want an int. You just said we use the int method to do that, right? Hope it's making sense. But besides that, the math package that we will soon, you know, figure out how to use in Python comes bundled with some pretty interesting methods, right? So things like the ceiling function, so the ceil, the math.ceil function or method, and the math.flow method, right? What these methods do is they give us a lot more control when it comes to floating point numbers, right? Case in point. I'm dividing 1 by 3, but I don't want my I want my result to be rounded off to the nearest let's say 2 decimal places, well, maybe the nearest integer actually, or 2 decimal places or integer. There might be instances when I might want this result to be formatted in a certain way, right? And these methods become really useful, right? What math.ceiling does is, what does it do? What happens when we seal something? I don't know. She knows. She's writing it down. Don't know. What do you suppose is happening here, by the way, guys? But how are we rounding it off? You see, guys, how are we rounding off? I'm trying to figure out if we can look at how are we rounding it off here? Can anyone guess? We are rounding off to the nearest integer value that is greater than the input value, right? But what the math.flow function does is it does something really bizarre, right? Right? It returns the maximum integer that is smaller than the input value. Irrespective of, like mathematically, we know that from algebra. I mean, in an ideal case, when you're using, when you have like 1.91, we know that ideally, if you want to round it off to zero decimal places, this should be 2, right? Right? But 1.91 is not 2 here. That's what we're saying. It's 1. The round built-in function, however, ladies and gentlemen, what the round method is, it's a built-in function. It exhibits similar behavior as the math.co and math.flow, but what it does is, and I want us to figure out which of the two, the math.flow and the math.ceiling, correspond to the round method, right? The round method actually does what we would otherwise normally expect. By default, it rounds off your result to zero decimal places, but you can explicitly feed it a second parameter value to specify how many decimal places you want, right? Right? But what it does is behavior similar to what? Is it math.co or math.flow here? She knows, right? Oh, but they already said the answer. Sorry? Oh. Would it? Would it? So the beauty with what we're doing is we can always try it out. No guessing games here. This is not a guessing game. Math.c? 4 point what? Great. Hope this is making sense. What's your name? Sorry.
Kyla.
My name is Piri. I'm not sir. Yes. No, but that's fine. Sorry, it's fine. But I'm just saying, that was a joke, by the way. No laughing. But
what do you do if math is not defined?
Oh, we're coming to that. You need to explicitly, I mentioned that we need to explicitly, can you hold on to that? We want to explain right now. We're just trying to do a comparison between these two math methods and round, assuming that we already know how to import maths. But we are coming to that, right? We are saying that the math module comes bundled with Python, right? And how we do it is, this is syntax, right? Rules. We mentioned that the only thing we need to know is rules and logic, right? We already know logic, everybody's born with logic, but the rules are what we need to understand. And the rules are simple. With time, you realize that the rules are simple, and you remember me. You remember, Piri said the rules were simple, and he was right, right? He probably laughed at me, you know. He looked like he knew what he was doing, but it was simple stuff. But the way we tell Python that we want to explicitly use those functions in the math module is we need to import the math module. And the first option of doing that is we just write the import statement followed by the name of the module, right? Import is a reserved word, just like print. Right? And eval. Right? And input. What that means is you can never use import as a variable name. Those are the rules, right? Do you think we can try and check if the rules are correct? Voila. But import one works, right? That's what we're saying. The rules. Right? So when you explicitly tell Python that you want to import that module, then you can take advantage of all the nice and fancy methods that exist within that module, right? And one of those methods happens to be a square root, right? So you can use a math.square root function to get the square root of a given number, right? We are saying importing is as simple as this, ladies and gentlemen. Import math. Kyla, do you want to do this before you run your code now? This should work, right? Right. And then you evoke whatever method you want from the math module, right? Nothing will happen here, we know that. You probably need to print it first. And it works, right? For those of us that feel so excited about this, do this. Import. You can import when you go home, you know, when you're tired. Don't spend time on DC hubs. They will eat up your time. Don't download movies on the DC hub network. Import math. And then if you just do help math, It spits out all these interesting methods that you have in there. You know, echoes. I did this math numerical analysis a long time ago. I'm forgetting these things. This is CO function math with CO, cosine functions, all these fancy things, right? Things that are already available to us. All we have to do is import the module and then use these fancy functions. Oh, log. What's log of... guys, what's log of... I don't know what log of 5 is. I just remembered. I don't know why I thought of 5, but... log of 5. We can do all these fancy things, right? Is this making sense? What we need to... The takeaway point here, guys, is that for us to use any, whatever method or function that exists within the math module, what we have to do is first of all explicitly have the import statement, and then we specify the function by using the dot operator. So module name dot, the method that we want to use, right? And the import statement is always the first line in your line of code. So what we're saying is that, I forgot to mention this with the other guys, you can't have, I wonder if this is 4, and then... Oh, it works, but... Well, not the first line, I think it's supposed in Java or something. I'm surprised it works, right? But you can't use it before... So you can't use it before you explicitly import the package, right? Make sure you import it first, right? I'm surprised that it accepts this. Is it Java? I don't know. Right. An alternative is, instead of importing the module name, what you do is you can use a different syntax. So you use the from reserved word followed by the module name, and then the import reserved word followed by the function within the module that you want to import, right? The only difference being that when you use this, when you use approach number 2, you can call the functions without explicitly using the dot operator, right? So whenever you issue from math import square root, you can just as well call the module name. So remember, we used import math here. I can't do this, right? But if I say from math import square root, then I can do that. That's what we're saying, right? Oh, 33. Okay. And we already mentioned that we already saw those really interesting methods when we looked at the Python documentation. Screenshot just shows some sample functions that we've already seen. Fact that there are some trig functions that you might find useful in case you're writing, I don't know, an exciting program for your friend who is a math major or something, right? So let's get our hands dirty and look at a simple problem that makes use of the math library. And we're going to use our four-step process and perhaps three-step process if we want to condense it, right? Because we already know that when you have a right-angled triangle, we can use a Pythagoras theorem to compute x, which is the hypotenuse, right? We know the formula because we probably came the exam that we wrote in high school, right? So we're going to write this. simple process, same process, rather, Pythagoras theorem. Right? Date is February 23rd, 2016. So what we're saying is if we follow that four-step process, or three-step if you want, we can do computation. Let's stick with four, conversion. Result. The first step is easy, right? How many input values do we need here? If we want to calculate x, how many input values do we need? Two input values, right? We need the adjacent, the values from the two sides, right, to compute the hypotenuse, right? So we need side number 1, right? We need side number 2. So at this point, what we're doing in line number 6 and 7 is fairly trivial because we already understand what's going on here. The only hard work is going to be using or leveraging the math functions to actually run the formula for computing the hypotenuse, right? So tell the input, say, enter side one, right? I copy paste this. Enter side number two, right? And then we will do the conversion for the two sides, right? This we understand, all of us, right? What we're doing now. Right? What is the formula for, hi, you have glasses like me. What's the formula for Pythagoras' theorem? Thank you very much. So we need a variable to hold the result, right? We just call it result. And then what she's saying is that, okay, a squared. How do we square values here? Thank you very much. And this is, it's happening right now. There are a range of answers coming out, and we use all of them, right? Star, star, two, asterisk, asterisk, two. We're saying var side one squared plus var side two times var side two. We're saying that this expression multiplying a number by itself is the same as this number star, star squared, right? Thank you. Incidentally, we could just as well have said math.pow the side, comma, two. There's a power function, math.pow. The power of 2 to 3 is 8. That's what we're saying. A range of options, take your pick, whatever you fancy. So what we're saying is we need the square root of the result here, right? And we just discovered that the math module has square root. Sorry about that. Is this making sense, good people? Thank you. So we give this program to probably a third grade or something. What values should we? What value should we? Why did I not? What is this? What value should we use as input here, guys? I'm sorry about that. This thing's supposed to be working. What value should we use, guys? In or not. The thing is, I don't know if this thing is charging. Oh, it is charging. Old age, right? I couldn't see that it was. Blah. I'm sorry. Can anyone see any other PowerPoint? This thing doesn't seem to be working. Is that? Please, what the fuck is this happening? I'm sorry. That was weird. Sorry, can we see a power pack somewhere? My eyes, right? Under the what? Which board? Thank you. I apologize for that. The gods are not. I don't understand why this thing is not working, right? Really? This has to be the most, well, so the thing is my, oh, thank you. Which side? Guys, I'm really sorry about this. This is really embarrassing. And you know what? The funny thing is, the embarrassment is actually being recorded right now, which is really fucking shit. Sorry about that. You know what I did? So what they do is they ask you if you wanna what sort of license you want to use for the recorded lecture sessions, and I foolishly said Creative Commons share alike, right? The whole world is gonna see us fumble here. But right, so sorry about that, guys. All right, so what we're saying is that we can leverage the. And everything is a mess, including the mouse. We can leverage the math square root function, the computation. There we go. So we're saying what values can we use here? Three. What else?
Four.
And we know the result is
five.
No. Why? Thank you. We understand, right? Fifth step, import. Clearly, our four-step process has mutated into a five-step process, right? All right. So quickly, again, so here's an interesting program, right? And we're not going to write this in class because time, there's something else towards the end that I want us to look at. We just showcase what we did with the other class. I was saying the other class that the youngest of my three siblings is a vet, and the other time I was speaking to him, I haven't seen him in like about maybe 2.5 years now. So speaking to him, he tells me he adopted a dog. Now he has a dog at home and a cat. He lives alone. I'm telling you, what do you do with a dog? He leaves it at home in a cage, and then it sounds cruel, but it's fine. So he has a dog, right? And here's the thing. Apparently, people have figured out a way of computing dog years into human years, right? We all know that, I mean, life expectancy of a dog, I don't know, I was reading somewhere that like the vast majority of them will live up like 10 or something, 15, I don't know. But there's a formula that we can use. We can create a formula to compute the equivalent of human years when we enter the dog years, right? So what we're saying is the formula exists in this link. We can look at this link. If you have a dog that's 5 years old, the first 2 years are computed by multiplying 5 human years to the 2, right? So if the dog is 5 years old, then you know that you are going to multiply the first 2 years by 10.5, and then the remaining 3 years by what? By 4, right? Simple formula. This is, as it so happens, you realize that it's very easy when we look at selection statements, right? Which is ideally a conventional way of doing things. This is how most people do it. It's a smart way of doing things. But there's a brute force method that we can use, right? And what we did with the guys is we did the dog years, right? We're saying we can ask the user for input. In this case, it's one input, dog years. Enter the number of, so I'd ask my brother, enter the number of years of your dog. Perhaps it's 2 now, I think it's 2 years old. And then what we're doing, look at what we're doing in line number 7. This is really important. What we're doing is, it's a two-step process. We're saying that our algorithm, based on the spec, is in such a manner that the first 2 years are multiplied by 10.5, and then the remaining years are multiplied by 4, right? But how do we compute the remaining years? We just subtract dog years minus 2, right? So for us to figure out, when a user enters 5, how do we split the 2 years from the remaining 3, as an example, the 5-year-old dog, right? What we do is we can use the minimum function and tell Python to say, within our program, we say, when a user enters the number of dog years, first of all, check check if the number of check if the number of dog years is what? Two or less. If the number of dog years is less than two, what are we going to do? And I just realized I think there's something a bit off with this example. I'm not sure, I could probably cross-check it. But what we're doing with the algorithm is we're first of all checking. If the number of, we get the minimum of the dog years that are entered. So if it's five, we know that five is not, the minimum of five and two is what? Two, right? So what that means is we are already getting the two, right? Multiplying the two by 10.5. And then we say 5 minus 2, that's the remaining 3 years, right? And then we multiply by 4, and then we get the result. It's as simple as that. Think over this, and then see what happens, right? Finally, guys, I wish you could do periodical compounding here, compound interest. The banks, right, they do this. But we can look at this at our own time. But what I wanted to mention before we go is that there's a... The world, I mean, I tell people that I think I'm fortunate that I live in such exciting times. There's a lot going on, right? I mean, it's not just like learning how to program in Python. I mean, people are doing exciting things. One of the exciting things people are doing in the Department of Computer Science, I happen to be a graduate student in the Department of Computer Science, is that people that conduct research in AI, artificial intelligence, right? Cool stuff, right? Some time back, in 2014, and I was looking this up, I remembered about it when I was looking at this slide, and then I was trying to look at the, when that news actually popped up. In 2014, mid-2014, some programmers, I think from Ukraine, I don't know, the UK and the US or something, Stanford and Yale, they created a bot, right? And then they did a Turing test for the first time, I think, to commemorate Alan Turing's 60 years after Alan Turing's death, they created that chatbot and then tested it using the Turing test, and they discovered that it actually passed, right? Exciting stuff. But what I wanted us to look at is, but that's fine. So I wanted to, so this is a funny example, sorry.
How do you do?
An example, simple problem that the computer type your problem. People are living here, right? most of the time. I'm sad. Bye. Guys, I just want to say, today's my last day. Please, this is supposed to be, school is supposed to be fun. And these are your formative years. Work hard, make friends. This is amazing. Have fun. You know, 3 years from now, 5 years from now, you'll be like, I don't know, multimillionaires. You'll be programming spaceships or something. I don't know. And I'll be there, you know, saying, bye, see you. Hi. I'm fine, thanks. How are you? Nice hat.
Thank you.
Yeah, I really like it.